Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and we will be talking brain in this learning objective video. Now, I want to begin this by noting that this is a very superficial survey of the major features of the brain. You will explore considerably more detail regarding structure and, in particular, function in other parts of the curriculum. But the goal here is really for you to have a general sense of where these structures are located, particularly when discussing them with the surrounding structures such as meninges and neurovasculature of the brain in upcoming videos. All right, excellent. Let's get started. Now, I hope you recall that the brain is a component of the central nervous system. So with the spinal cord, so brain plus spinal cord equals central nervous system. We will be talking about cranial nerves in upcoming learning objectives. And even though they originate from the brain, once they branch off, they're actually considered part of the peripheral nervous system, or the PNS. Again, this is going to be the most superficial of superficial surveys. So if you're getting excited about learning the function of these structures, this is not the video for it. This is just to get an idea of where these things are located. And these right here are the major features that we are going to discuss. We will start with the cerebrum, as it is the largest and most dominant feature when viewing the brain. So everything I am outlining right here is considered part of the cerebrum. So when you're viewing from most views, so say from this lateral view or from this anterior view, it is the dominant structure. It is all you can see from this superior view right here. So that's all cerebrum right here. Often people incorrectly assume the brain is just the cerebrum. We know that's not true, as there's other structures we'll discuss later. Okay, so the cerebrum is composed of the right and left cerebral hemispheres, as well as deep basal ganglia. And these are composed of subcortical nuclei. Recall that nuclei are composed of cell bodies of neurons. And since we're doing just a superficial survey, we certainly won't be able to view these basal ganglia. But you can certainly view the cerebral hemispheres, and there are some features that are very easily observable. First, all of these kind of folds around these regions of the brain are referred to as gyri or gyrus, if you're talking singular. So these ridges or folds of the cerebral cortex that really characterizes the cerebral surface of the brain. And these are generally surrounded by sulci, which are these depressions or kind of grooves of the gyri. So if you're talking, so they're going to be very closely associated with the gyrus. The gyri and the sulci will really function to increase the surface area of the brain, which is important because we're pretty stringently constrained by the surrounding bone with the size that the brain can be. So this allows for a larger surface area. Additionally, in certain areas, there are more prominent separations or clefts to separate certain components of the cerebrum, and these are referred to as fissures. The largest and dominant feature is the longitudinal cerebral fissure, which is located between the right and left cerebral hemispheres. Each cerebral hemisphere is separated conceptually into various lobes. Specifically, you have the frontal, as well as parietal, temporal, and occipital lobe. So you have these sets of lobes on each cerebral hemisphere. And they're named after the surrounding bones, but it's important to note that they do not match up exactly to those overlying bones. All right. Moving on to some structures that you have to look at in this specific view. So we are looking at a sagittal section of the brain. We often refer to this as a hemisected brain. So you say you're looking at a right hemisection or a left hemisection. So kind of think you began dividing the cerebral hemispheres at that longitudinal cerebral fissure and just continue to the other components of the brain. So separating the right side of the brain from the left side of the brain, and you're viewing some of the deeper structures. You can see here in this image the larger cerebral cortex portion, so those gyri kind of all over the place, and the sulci in between. Also, part of the cerebrum, when you're looking at this internal portion view of the hemisection, you have this area called the corpus callosum, which is important in terms of communication between the right and the left cerebral hemispheres. So still portions of the cerebrum here, but we need to move on from the cerebrum at some point. Now, looking closer into this region right here, you are looking at the diencephalon. And the diencephalon is a strange one. It is often described as the central core of the brain, and it is not visible at all from the external view. So you have to be looking at this view. Or even deeper dissections. And this will consist of the dorsal thalamus, the hypothalamus, as well as the epithalamus, which is the posterior element of the diencephalon. You really can't see it too well. You have to get in there really well to see it. Well, you can see a little bit of the pineal gland here, which is a component of it. So these are deeper structures, it's good to know that they exist in this general location, but you will not have to identify these on our end in anatomy. Next, I want to discuss the hypophysis, aka the pituitary gland, which is connected via the infundibulum of the hypothalamus to the diencephalon. So here is the pituitary gland. You can see it's really closely associated here. This region that connects it's referred to as the infundibulum. And we know that it's often considered, the pituitary gland is often considered a part of the diencephalon based on development, particularly the posterior portion of the pituitary gland. We know the function of this endocrine gland is hugely important for many metabolic processes, particularly in terms of growth. Okay, so again, these features, or the functions of all these super cool features will be discussed in other areas of the curriculum. Our major focus here is just kind of that general location. Okay, moving to the brainstem, which is composed of the proximal midbrain, the intermediate pons here in pink, and the distal medulla oblongata, often just kind of shortened to the medulla. It is the medulla that is continuous with the spinal cord at the foramen magnum of the occipital bone. So say if we added the bone here, you would have the foramen magnum, that nice big hole, basically. And so once you get to the foramen magnum from there, this would be spinal cord. We will discuss these structures that I just mentioned of the brainstem in a bit more detail when we discuss the origin of the cranial nerves, as most are originating from this region. And last but certainly not least is the cerebellum. I often conceptualize this as a mini cerebrum, although these structures have some very big differences in terms of function. But the reason I think of it that way is because the cerebellum also has two hemispheres. You can see if we're looking at a posterior view here, this would be the right and this would be the left cerebellar hemispheres. These are going to be connected by a small structure called the vermis, which you can't really see well in any of these images, but you'd have that connection similar to you had that corpus callosum of the cerebrum. Just of note, the relative similarity in the names between cerebrum and cerebellum is a source of consternation of many students and maybe even this faculty member that you are listening to. Make sure you pay special attention to when, say, you're talking about the name of an artery or a vein, to make sure you're differentiating between a cerebral or cerebellar artery, because they're very close in terms of spelling as well as in terms of pronunciation. All right, excellent. So this was your superficial survey of the brain. Those are the major structures you need to know in terms of general location as we continue our more detailed dives into function and neurovascular supply. Thank you for your time and attention here, and have a great rest of your day.